to start in John 16, verse 8, in just a moment. A little introduction, okay? John 16, verse 8. A verse that's been very precious to me and a very significant part of our prophetic history. We're here on our fifth session. On the third night, we're at 12 nights of seeking the Lord, and at the end of this 50 days of devotion, the last 12 nights we're seeking the Lord together. We're all gathering together, and on the third night, we did two sessions. So last night, the fourth night, we did something a little different. We talked about the end of the age just from things that are happening at current events and from the Scripture, so we didn't really tell prophetic history. So now it's our fifth night, and we're right on track. It's our fifth time of telling the prophetic history, because we told two sessions on Thursday night, and so many of you stayed. I appreciate just the interest that was in your heart, and I feel like the Lord touched a few people in the ministry time afterwards and really re-enlisted them to the front lines, and that's, I think, why the Lord wanted to be that way. But here we're going to look at a number of prophetic testimonies, maybe five of them, around John 16, verse 8. Now, this is a verse that will be new to some of you. And even maybe you're not even that interested in it, but it's a critical part of our future. It's a critical part of our promise. It's a critical part of the end time harvest. Jesus is speaking, John 16:8. And when He comes, when the Holy Spirit comes, the Helper of verse 7, Jesus is speaking about the Holy Spirit. He will convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and judgment. This is so much more intense than what most of us are thinking. When the Holy Spirit comes, and what it means in our context, because he's been present in the midst of the people of God since Pentecost, but when He manifests His power in given gatherings, when He comes, but when He manifests His power, I'm going to add a few words, He will release supernatural power to pierce the human spirit in a way that you and I have never seen before. We think of our great future is in signs and wonders. And beloved, our future is dynamically related to signs and wonders in terms of healings I'm talking about. But let me tell you, there's something even more powerful, and I want to underline the word M-O-R-E, more powerful than raising the dead. Something more powerful than blind eyes opening up. It's apostolic preaching anointed with the very substance of the Holy Spirit's life, piercing men's hearts and women's hearts and cutting them asunder like a sword, has more powerful effect. Not that we have to compare the two, but in history, people see the miracles and a year later, they're doing something entirely different. But through history, when the spirit of conviction fastens upon their heart the word of God like a barbed arrow that will not let loose, they are thoroughly and utterly convicted and converted supernaturally. Now, we want the two together. But everybody knows about the miracles. And either tomorrow night or the next night, whatever, we're going to talk about four or five things that are promising miracles. And there's nobody loves miracles more than I do. I'm really into that. But I'm talking to people who love miracles, and I'm wanting to get your attention. Historically, in terms of equipping us to bring nations to the Lord, I'm talking about the body of Christ. The us is the corporate body of Christ worldwide. We have to get a vision for apostolic preaching. And I don't mean get a vision for it, meaning let's change our doctrine and let's only preach what Peter preached in those sermons in the book of Acts. Let's get those three sermons down. And that's not exactly what I mean, although that's certainly a worthy thing to do. I'm talking about we need a vision of where the power realm will take us in terms of God's promise and God's plan for the end time church. The power realm as it related to speaking words. Now, this is something that has fascinated me for 25 years. I've been an ardent student of the subject of apostolic conviction. Apostolic, I mean, the level of conviction the apostles had in the early church plus some. That's what I mean. When Jesus spoke, He spoke as one with authority from heaven. The hearts of multitudes were moved at His very words. Not because his words, not because the content of the words were just so tender like they're moved by a poet. It's not that kind of thing. It's because there was a power. There was an authority. The one that spoke in Genesis 1 and created was the one that was speaking in the mode of preaching. And that same one is going to preach and speak and sing through his people. Now, this conviction is going to come through preaching. John 16:8. It's going to come through singing. Hebrews 2, verse 11 and 12. Jesus is going to sing to his Father in the midst of the congregation through the body of Christ. He's going to loose the songs of his heart, same as preaching. He's going to sing back to his Father in the presence of stadiums filled with people. It's called prophetic singing. It's Jesus singing in the midst of the congregation back to his Father in power. And I just can't emphasize enough the number of times the Lord has said that prophetic singing, the song of the Lord, is really made of the same stuff as apostolic preaching. Meaning it's the words of God's heart with unction. One has music, one doesn't. They go together. Okay, let me give you a couple examples from history. Because if I don't tell you these examples from history, you may not appreciate the stories and the prophetic testimonies. And why do I want you to appreciate them? For one reason, I want you to get a vision to be one of these people. I've had this vision, and I hope that doesn't sound like, oh, aren't I something? I've had this vision, but that's not my point. My point is this. I've had this vision for 25 years, and it has been used of God, the vision to enter into a supernatural realm of proclamation that has, in the grace of God, sustained me to press through years of fasting and prayer. And it's because I know that I know on the other end of this thing, there is a breakthrough of power on utterance, whether singing or speaking, that will shake nations. That's the vision that I want 20-year-olds to get. That's why I'm telling this to you. And I'm telling you my story because this has really motivated me powerfully over the years. This is really neat. It just strikes me again. You know how these things strike you? It was today, because it was on my son's the day he was born. October 31st, it was his birthday. I just remember. It's just fun to put that together. Because my favorite preacher through church history is a man named David Brainerd. And I heard Jonathan Edwards, who's probably my second favorite preacher. But anyway, Jonathan Edwards, I had this, he talked about this man, and I heard the stories of this man named David Brainerd. And I asked everybody, who's David Brainerd? He was, died about 17, maybe 47, 48, and was a missionary to the Native Americans on the East Coast. He died at age 29. And he moved in the power of God in preaching. I heard stories about him. I was 22, 23 years old. And I couldn't find a book on David Brainerd. And so the hospital that Diane goes to for Luke to be born, next to it, is a seminary. So this is my birthday, too. I go in this seminary, and there's the book, the original. Well, I don't mean original copy, but I mean the Jonathan Edwards memoirs of David Brainerd right there. And I looked at the lady and I said, unbelievable. She goes, well, nobody's ever checked it out. And I said, unbelievable. Here it is, October 31st. Then something really unbelievable happened a few hours later, the birth of our little Lukey boy. And so, but it just so happens, it's this very day, it just strikes me. This is beautiful. Anyway, I read the life of David. I asked them, I said, would you Xerox this? The lady goes, the whole book? I go, would you just please, I will pay you anything. And she did it. She gave me the book. She Xeroxed it and gave it to me. And I read that book. I've had it for years. And I began to read the life of David Brainerd. And oh my goodness, the power that hit this man's life when he would preach. He would be out in the wilderness speaking through a drunken interpreter. A drunken one of the tribesmen that he paid that could speak English, and the power of God hit, and these, he called them the heathen. They knew nothing. They've never heard of the God of the white. white man, as they called him. And the power of God descended, and they would be on the ground groaning and travailing, having never heard the gospel, never been to a meeting, through a drunken interpreter. 50 of them, 43 of them, this would happen over and over, would be on the ground sobbing and weeping, soundly converted. And Jonathan Edwards did the research later, 10 years later. Again, that's not exactly 10 years, but some years later, some of the converts were men and women of such, he called them singular devotion, that he knew almost nobody who had the devotion of the converts of David Brainerd. And then, of course, the comment of it is, the reason for it is because of the power upon this man's preaching. David Brainerd, of course, the famous story of him. One day the spirit of intercession came on David Brainerd. He was out laying in the snow. He had tuberculosis. That's why he died. He's 29 years old. He lived out in the open with tuberculosis. He had such a crushing burden for the Native Americans. He says, I do not care. And Jonathan Edwards took him in like a son and lived in his house in the last 18 weeks of his life. And his daughter nursed him. And he died in his home, and Jonathan Edwards, the famous revivalist, and Brainerd became intimate friends. And Edwards says, I know of no other man that has equaled the young David Brainerd in piety and purity and holiness and an abandonment to God. But he would tell the stories of how Brainerd would be out in the snow and be there 4 and 5 hours under the burden of travail, sweating. And the snow was melted around him, and he's sweating, coughing up blood. But the burden of God, I don't mean something he contrived, laid hold of him. And then the next day, the power of God would hit a tribe, and maybe 180, 190 people would be there. And it would, the multitudes would be converted relative to the number of the tribe, a high percent. And then years later, the fruit was astounding, that of even some of the great awakening that was sweeping through New England, The native converts were the most devout 10 years later under the preaching of Brainerd. And I began to read this. You know, Brainerd was 24, 25, 26, 27. I was maybe 23. Well, I was 23 at the time. I was 23 years old. And I was 23 when Luke was born. And so there, I can do it there. And I began to say, oh, my goodness. I was sick. I was absolutely sick. I was ruined with a vision to have this. Then I read about Jonathan Edwards. He did the same thing. You've heard the story, the famous story when he preached on Psalm 7, verse 11, sinners in the hands of an angry God, and how he preached on hell. He read it from it. He wrote it all down for, 20 pages or whatever. Read it by candlelight at a night meeting. They didn't have electricity. And he looked out, and the people in the church were, it says their hands, the white knuckle thing, gripping and losing their strength. And they were screaming and wailing as he read this famous sermon. And this happened many times. I don't mean just a sermon when Jonathan Edwards would preach. And he said the same thing. Him and David Brainerd had tapped into reality. Well, then on the other side, there was Whitfield and Wesley over in England doing the same thing. Entering into powerful prayer and then a power of conviction where multitudes, thousands, here's young George Wesley, 22 years old, 10,000, 20,000 would come, and the power of God would descend like a blanket, and they would wail and scream and cry out, and the same thing with Wesley. Wesley, Whitfield, Edwards, and Brainerd, all just in that clustered together in that same general time. Two on this side, two on that side, and of course Wesley and Whitfield came over here many times, and they all operated the same power, the East Coast of America and England was set ablaze by apostolic preaching. They'd never seen anything like it at this level. And I was, of course, when you read Edwards, it leads you to Brainerd, and then Brainerd, it leads you right to the other ones. And then I just lost my appetite for life. I just read their stories night and day, and I said, God, I got to do this. And I'd have my, and I'm not down on how things are today. I'm very grateful. grateful for everything God's given us in the grace of God. But I had a burning vision. And I had a, you know, I'd have a little lively little Bible study. I mean, most of them are pretty boring, but every now and then I have a lively little Bible study that I'd lead. And somebody would say, oh, this is awesome. And nothing could cure my heart from the vision of having my brainer dead. I said, I don't care. Nothing will satisfy me till stadiums are filled and 80,000 are groaning after the preaching. That's the only vision I will be satisfied with in terms of preaching. I don't care if there's 5,000 and they go, wow, what a sermon. Man, that moved me. That means nothing to me, honestly, compared to where God has spoken to my heart we're going, where the end time church is going. Then, right after that, in the wake of that, these four guys, I stumbled into Charles Finney. Oh, my goodness. About 100 years later. Charles Finney, in my opinion, his theology is disastrous, but his anointing was stunning. Stunning. One of my favorite men of all of history is Charles Finney. And the reason I believe his theology is disastrous is because I preached for years. No, I did, and I just locked so many hearts in a religious spirit that I had to unlock them, and the Lord, it was kind of like my seminary experience. I got so excited by the power on his ministry that I assumed that because he was anointed, he understood doctrine, because being anointed and understanding doctrine aren't exactly the same thing. But in the early days, I thought they were. And then I had to work my way back through all of the issues and thinking through. Well, and it was so heartbreaking to think Finney made a mistake. But anyway, it's many years later, and I love Charles Finney desperately. When I'm in heaven, I'll say, Charles Finney, you so impacted my life. Charles Finney would go into a factory. This is a famous story. Most of you know this. You want to read the biography of Charles Finney. You really, really do want to read these biographies. And I read all these when I was in my 23rd and 24th year. And I read them over and over and over in two and three different versions, different people's biographies of them. And their autobiography, anything I could. I just lived on a steady diet of these guys. And we have to get that kind of vision back. And now, years later, 24, 25 years later, I could see it was a sovereign setup because the Lord was wiring me for something to be completely ruined for business as usual in the realm of preaching, as well as in the realm of miracles, as well as in the realm of guidance, God speaking prophetically from heaven. All three realms, not just one. And Charles Finney would go into the factory. This is one. Oh, there's so many good Finney stories. I used to preach. I used to bring the Finney books up, just read like an hour's worth on Sunday morning. And, you know, people would just go like, you know, you need to get a bunch of guys that are doing what you're doing and just go tell them these stories. Okay, so Charles Finney, one of the famous stories, and you want to read these stories. He walks into the factory. The power of God's on him. It says, he goes, I look up, I fasten my gaze upon the workers. One lady's hand begins to tremble. I've not uttered a word yet. Her hand begins to tremble. Others gather around. He says, before long, and I don't remember the number because it's been a few years since I've read the story, but I've read it publicly on a number of occasions, and all of a sudden there's several hundred there sobbing on the floor. He says, I've not yet opened my mouth. He says, then I spoke as though a hammer came from heaven and shattered their hearts like a rock. And he goes, I trust they were hopefully converted. He left them, and for hours, they were left. The whole factory was shut down. And for he left, and for hours, 5 and 10 hours later, they were left there under the power of God because of the preaching of a weak man with apostolic authority. He went to New York City in 1857. And this is what he says in his biography. Charles Finney was a lawyer who got converted, and God just baptized him with fire and power for preaching. You know, I don't know how many people in church history had entered into the realm he entered into. I know Brainerd did, but Finney carried this for years. And in 1957, he went to New York City, and he says, in 8 weeks, I believe, it's conservative to say, I believe it's accurate to say, this is Finney's language, something like that. He says, 500,000 converts in 8 weeks. 60,000 a week were being saved, according to his numbers. Someone says, well, you know, what if he exaggerated? Okay. 30,000 a week were being saved. Say he doubled it. It was only 30,000 a week. No microphones. Open air preaching. could give you story after story of the few examples through history of apostolic preaching. It is heavenly. It is powerful. It will cut a city. It will cut a nation in two. Finney said, Edward said, Wesley said, Whitfield, Brainerd, they all used the same language. They said it was like my words became like a hammer that shattered the rock of human resistance. They would use words like my words were like fire, and the hearts of the people were like grass, and they were effortless in their ability to even resist the power of the word. All of them were on the floor. They would use words like language like my words were like a sword that pierced and cut asunder the human heart. And beloved, we're talking about more than an inspirational meeting where you walk out going, man, I like that. I'm going for it now. I'm talking about something. Here's the power of it. The word of God, the truth of God, fastens onto the human heart and it drives them, man, if I could use that word, to an abandonment, and it has a permanent impact upon their life. Meaning, it goes on for months and months and years, not just something that was for the weekend. We need a vision for apostolic preaching in the house of God. And until you get a vision for this, you don't press for it. You don't press for it. I love what Dwayne Roberts said that at one of the meetings. He said, I decided, whether it was about a year or two ago, he said, I've got to get authority on my life. I don't have authority on my life. And we realize that everybody in the name of Jesus has a certain measure of authority inherent in being born again. But he was talking about a manifestation of power in his preaching. He said, I don't care what it costs me. I'm going to find a way in this next season to touch the realm of authority when I preach. And that's getting a vision for this. Now I'm going to go to the stories. Because I think some of you are going, okay, that John 16:8. Okay, that works. I hope we have to have a vision for this. Okay, so now David Brainerd, who is just my Brainerd and Lake, you know, and then Bernard of Clairvaux is the same way in France, but let's not go there, but it's the same kind of deal. Signs and wonders and conviction to thousands of people he would preach to in the open air, you know, in the 11th century. Okay, 12th century. So I had this, Brainerd was my guy. He was my, I got my book, October 31st, 1978. I got two gifts. The big gift was my son, the little gift was the book, and the little gift was good gift too. And so I began to read it, and I said, I'm going to be a David Brainerd. I'm going for it. And no man is going to turn me back. Because you know what? If you press into this, you'll run into leaders that will get all nervous. Because you're not satisfied with the status quo, and they will get disturbed because you're disturbing them. If you're not happy with what's happening, as long as you want a little bit more, they don't mind. But if you get like really resolute about this, it's disturbing because the underlining statement is, you mean it's not good enough like it is? I mean, a little bit better, of course, but come on, give me a break. I'm going to say this, it is my passion to raise up young men and young women that have the vision of David Brainerd and Finney for preaching. And we will get behind you and push you into this. We will push you into this. Because I wrestled with so many guys through the years who wanted to steal this. And he said, well, you got to be practical. I don't want to be practical. I see John 16:8. I've seen historical records that are verified through many people besides these men about their lives. I've got to do this. I don't want to be practical. It's not practical for the world to live in sin with no anointed preaching around the earth except for a few rare occasions. So I began to read Brainerd. And here's something I really discovered about Brainerd. It was an equation. Now, the equations are never fully perfect, but when Brainerd would have a release of prayer, a release of authority in prayer, when this spirit of groaning, I don't mean the made-up groaning where everybody gets in the room and says, tonight we're going to groan, okay, that we groan. I've been in a handful of prayer meetings over the years where we're going to call groaning meetings, travail meetings. We all get in, we do a couple of minutes of warm-up music, turn the music off, okay, now we're starting, and everyone goes for 5, 6, 7, 8 minutes as long as they get, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm not even against that. I'll take any kind of prayer meeting. No, I will. I'll take a prayer meeting, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about where, and I led a few of those, to be honest. I tried to jumpstart it. Actually, I was the guy that led them. Okay, so there you have it. I was going to keep the guy anonymous, but it just slipped out there. You go 7 or 8 minutes. You go 15 minutes due to strength, you know, if you get a bunch of rowdy guys in a room. But it's over when it's over, and it's like, well, there you have it. That was kind of pathetic, you know. Although I believe it touches God's heart. I really do. But I'm talking about not the, we schedule the groaning and we come groan. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about when God schedules it and God lays hold of us. And then we have a manifest authority to lay hold of God. Now, we can lay hold of God anyway, but when there's a manifest, where we're cloaked in the presence, in intercession, and our intercession enters into the Hebrews 7:25 intercession of Jesus at the right hand, we tap into that life flow, and now God's gripped us, and now we grip God, and it's a whole different dilemma. A whole different dimension. So, Brainerd would talk about this, and then it would happen to him, you know, on Friday morning, then Friday afternoon, when the Indians would gather, he would preach, and the power would descend. And Brainerd will tell you, when he preached, that there was no power at all on him. And he would go into more ardent fasting and prayer. He says, once you touch it, you can't live without it, so they say. I haven't really touched it, but I trust the testimonies of history, and I believe it. And so, Here I am in St. Louis. It's 1982. We come to Kansas City at the end of 82 in November. But this is, you know, from January to November. And I'm a Brainerd fanatic. I'm preaching. I'm telling Brainerd stories on Sunday morning. We've had two solemn assemblies. They're only 3 days. 3 day solemn assemblies. And we used Joel chapter 2 and Daniel chapter 9. I mean, same old, same old. Which is good. If it isn't broke, don't fix it. The Daniel 9 and Joel 2 works. And we'd get together. And we would cry out for the power of conviction to hit the church. And so I'm in this context. And those solemn assemblies were I think, meaningful to the Lord that we did them. But I don't remember anything remarkable happening. But it was in that context, our whole gathering there in St. Louis, which that church is still going. And as a matter of fact, right after this 50-day thing is over, on Thursday, I go there Friday, and I'm with them, and they want to jump in full blast with everything we're doing here. They're still going 25 years later. It's a group of about 500, still about the same number it was back then. And they've maintained the fire. They've been leading near-daily prayer meetings for years and years and years and years. And so I just say that as an honor and a testimony. I've been there a number of times over the years, but just interacting with them and knowing they've led prayer meetings out of 25 years, many of the years, every day. I'm just so proud of them that they've stayed with it, the Brainerd, the Finney, and all this kind of thing. Some of the leaders have still maintained that in their heart. But I remember one Saturday night. Here it was. I don't remember, maybe March 82. We got our little four-member prayer meeting, and we're up there, and the first time in my life, the spirit of travail sovereignly from heaven hits me. Supernatural. A full Brainerd thing. And I'm there. And suddenly it seizes me. And I don't know what's happening. It's powerful. I begin to weep. And I'm real quiet about it. But I'm just, and it's on me. And I'm groaning and groaning. And I'm thinking, what is going on? It goes on for 30 minutes to an hour. I don't know. And I say in my little mind, I said, oh my goodness. This is a Brainerd thing. It's going to happen tomorrow. And I was so excited. And tomorrow, it did happen. It did happen. I didn't tell anybody. Even the guy in the spring. I was over there, and they just left, and I just stayed there. The time was up. I said, I'm going to keep going. And it just stayed on me for just not long, but 30 minutes to an hour. And then I didn't say a word. And the next morning, I said, God, I've got it. I'm here in the prayer lab. You know, I said, I got to check this out. And I preached the same old message that I was going to preach. And, now, 500 people present, and about, first time it ever happened, maybe 100 or 200 of them were noticeably weeping in the middle of the sermon. I'm preaching. I have authority. I'm aware of it. It's not at the level of the Finney, the Brainerd, but I'm, because I'm really watching it. Maybe 100, I don't know, 200. I don't really know, but all over the congregation, they were weeping, and people were, you know, just, you could hear them. And I called an altar call, and normally we would have like one person get saved on Sundays, which I love that. I mean, one person is one whole person. That works for me. But 25, 18, 25, whatever the number, some big number, They came forward. I said, oh my goodness, I can do this. I like this. And I went up and prayed for them. But afterwards, people said, man, that was a good service. And I am excited. I've tapped into something. Ooh, I got something. It's real. It's real. I'm about, maybe I'm 26, 27 years old then. 26 years old. And I'm going, ooh, I like it. I've tapped into something real. Then a month or two or three, whatever, later, I don't remember, it hits again on Saturday night. Same thing. I'm just in my Ephesians 1:17. There's five of us here. I'm pacing in our little bit, in our little room. Lord, release the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Lord, you know the spirit of wisdom and revelation. This is back in 1982, and I remember this thing started. Romans 8:26, groaning too deep for words. And I just knelt down, and I just went to the corner. I said, you guys, I'm just going to stay here a little bit longer. Just don't even go. And it just, I didn't tell him the last time or this time, because I'm just wanting to. You know, I'm so focused on it. I'm not interested in making it a display thing. And it hits me again, 30, 60 minutes. It's Saturday night again. I get up there Sunday morning. It's a few months after that one, same thing. About 20, 30 minutes into the message, about a 45-minute message, people start gently weeping, just gently. Not outward cries, but you could hear them sniffling and coughing and maybe, I didn't count, but maybe 100 of them. A few people, one or two people knelt down in the congregation, their chair, just knelt down by their chair and just started weeping. And, you know, you could just see their bodies moving. I said, this only happened to me once ever. And it was after the night of one of these groaning sessions. Same thing, a bunch of people could say maybe 10 or 20. I don't know the number, but more than the normal one or zero. I mean, it was record-breaking except for that one day, you know, the day it happened a few months earlier. People afterwards, what? This was a great service. Wow, things are really picking up. And it happens one more time. It happens three times in St. Louis. Then in June, this Augustine prophet, a guy comes by and says, you know, here's the audible voice of the Lord. In essence, it's what it's all said. Then you're going to Kansas City, and there's going to be a lot of young people, da 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 da. And then the summer of 1982, I go on a long fast, and then I go to Cairo, Egypt, and the Lord speaks it, and he says, night and day prayer is essential. And so I come to Kansas City, and I am wired for, oh, I can't wait. I mean, I got a great 6 months behind me, the audible voice of the Lord, the extended time of seeking the Lord, the experience in Cairo, Egypt. We come here, we are every day prayer meeting, 7 to 10 every night, and so I'm ready, and I'm just waiting for this arrow of intercession to hit me. You can't make it happen. It just comes when it comes. There's no way to make it happen. It's so sovereignly initiated by God. Now, the big day happens. The big day happens. Ooh, I love this story. I love it and I hate it. It's a great and a terrible story in my little heart. Okay, it's Easter. 1983. You know, we've been at the church 3 or 4 months. Since December we started, it's Easter. April 83. I wake up. Easter Sunday. It's maybe 6 or 7, I don't know what time. And I just kneel down, just kind of, I don't kneel that much. I mostly walk and or sit. And so I kneeled down and I said, Lord, I just want you to just, here it's Easter, it's our first, you know, I got a little congregation. 300 or 400 people here, probably going to be 5 or 10 visitors. I'd like somebody to get saved today. That'd really be great. And I say, Lord, I just want you to bless it. And groaning travail falls on me from heaven. I mean, within a minute, it says Romans 8:26, groaning with groanings too deep for words. The Holy Spirit's helping you. And it goes on, and I'm not going to get the times exactly right, but it 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock, 8:30, whatever, it goes on for a while. And way longer than the St. Louis thing. And it has like birth pangs. It grips you for 2 or 3 minutes really hard. And it's like it grips your body and then it relaxes for a minute or two. Then it grips you again and it's coming from heaven. It is not born of the earth. It's not born of zeal. It's not born of effort. It's not born of anything. It's a sovereign thing that you cannot produce. Finally, it lifted for 4 or 5 minutes. I had been sobbing for an hour or two. I don't know how long. I mean, weeping and travailing. The only time I've ever wept intercession was those three times in St. Louis of the 4 or 5 years I've been doing it hard. And I think, oh my goodness, this is all the fruit, you know. So I get in the car and I hurry up and get to the church. I get there before anybody and I go in the back room and I just knelt down and I go, Lord, and it hits me again. Hits me, maybe it's 9 or 9:30, I don't know, you know, I could be missing the time frames up here, but it hits me again. I go for an hour in my little office there in that new little church. Guys are knocking on the door. Hey, can we do that? Da, 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 da. I don't know what to do. I've never been in public where this happened. And I do what you want to do, you know. And so I slipped out in some back place because we were at a Fox Hill Office Park, 109th and Row, which was an executive office building, actually. It was just kind of a wild place to have a church. And it was just newly being renovated on the inside. There was a couple construction sites way at the other end. So I went over there just on a construction site, knelt down on some drywall. It hit me for an hour and a half again. My strength is so run out. I'm talking it maybe is 3 to 5 hours total. The other ones were 30 minutes. My eyes are swollen. My strength is gone. I have no strength. And this is exactly how Brandon would talk. And I'd say, this is really the real deal. And finally, the worship's gone. You know, it's Easter, so you don't go so long, but it's gone 45 minutes to an hour, and the guys are looking everywhere. I'm tucked around some piece of, you know, a drywall, a whole stack of it just laying down. The guy goes, you know, we did one more song like 5 times. Are you coming? I said, I'm coming. Yeah, I went in the bathroom, washed my face, and I look a mess. And so I get up there, and I preach. I start. I am so sure. I'm 3 for 3. And I got Finney and Brainerd and Wesley. I know it's God's way is my point. Their stories. I know it's God's way. And 5 minutes, 10 minutes, it was oppressed. It was oppressed. It was, I have what I call sermons that are dead, and I got those that are double dead. This was double dead. But I have faith because I know what just happened. And I'd say, this is the devil. And I stop, and in the name of Jesus, I break this thing open. And then I go for another 10 or 15 minutes. And it is so bad. A spirit of oppression. I'm not exaggerating to be funny. It was so bad. I stopped 15 minutes early. It was horrible. I am really hurting. I'm sitting there, standing there, and I said, okay, this. I said, you know, I'm just going to cut this a little bit short. Your hair, you know, it's a new church. Da, da, da. And people are going, praise God. No, for real they did. This is not a joke. This is a painful, it's funny, but it was painful. I am so confused. Nobody knows what's happened to me. No one knows about my equation of St. Louis. It's not something I preached about. It's something I was doing all my little internal math. You know, I got all my little things. I'm studying how this thing works. And so I can go for the rest of my life doing this. And I am heartbroken. I'm sick. And I'm up there, and I said, if anybody wants just to come forward and say, Lord, I would like to be touched by you. You know, why not? And so nobody came. So I dismissed them. And then, again, the 300 or 400 people, they're kind of mingling around in this little building. It's a building that seats about 700. So it's, you know, Bob Jones, this new prophetic guy, just met him, okay? We just had the first of spring when the snow melts. In March, it's April. So I've just known him. And I believe that he's from the Lord. And he's at the very far end of the building, so he doesn't see me. And I don't see him, and everybody's mingling around in front. And so it's maybe a building about 3 or 4 times the size of this one. And I was just up there. And there people were all talking. Hey, my name is this, because the church was so new, they didn't know each other. And there were 3 people standing there, 4 or 5 feet apart. Strangers. They were just standing there. They were coming up to answer that, hey, if you want God to even, if you just want him to touch you, just in case, come on up. They didn't come up immediately, but they came up the 5-minute mark. So I'm talking to new people, and a guy's got his eyes closed, and I go up to him, and I said, would you like prayer? And he just nodded his head. I'd never seen him before. And I put my finger on him. Listen to this. I put my finger on him. My finger. I didn't say, hardly said a word. I put my finger. I said, now, Lord, and when I did it, he fell to the ground, dropped, sobbing. I took a step back. I hadn't said anything. I just said, now, Lord. And he went, ugh! And he went down and was heaving, sobbing. unbeliever, first time at church. I kneeled down. I said, "Are you?" I mean, because you know, I got the theology, but I go, "Are you okay?" And he doesn't answer. He's sobbing because I'm worried, not thinking I'm anointed. I think I'm totally oppressed right now. And I'm going, "Are you okay?" And he doesn't answer. Just sobs. And he was going, "Jesus, Jesus." And I went, "That is the oddest thing I've seen." I looked at it. I went over here. And I'm just talking. The guy says, "Hey, I'm first time here, and da-da-da-da, good to meet you at our new little church here." And a lady's standing there, her eyes closed. Same thing, I go up to her. And I said, "Would you like prayer?" Nods her head. I put my finger on her forehead. She collapses to the ground and starts sobbing and groaning, "Mercy, please give me mercy." And I kneel down, and I kind of get it, and I'm saying, "You want Jesus to give you mercy?" She goes, "Please, Jesus." She's sobbing. Then another moment or two, you know, people are all mingled. Maybe there's 100 people mingling up there because it's a chatting time. Nobody came for the altar call. So these guys are just standing on. They don't know anybody except for maybe the guy that brought him. So I walk over here. Is another man. Same thing. I put my hand on his chest. I don't say a word except for, you know, "Can I pray for you?" But same thing. He collapses and starts sobbing. And I look back. Now it's 20 minutes. I am really observing this. Everybody's still talking, and they're in this crowd on the floor. Everybody's walking over them, and they're weeping. I'm going, "I have never seen anything like this." So I look at the back of the room, and there's Bob Jones with about 6 or 7 people sitting around a chair just at the very corner. And so I go back there, and because they want to get out of the walkway because Bob had something to share with him. I said, "How you doing, Bob?" He goes, "Well, you've had quite a day today, haven't you?" And I said, "Well, actually, I have had quite a day." He goes, "Oh, I know. I've seen the whole thing." Now, remember, I'm new with Bob. And we had the first of spring. I go, "Well, what do you mean? You've seen the whole thing?" He says, "Oh, the Lord sent you up to go fishing today, didn't he?" Now, he doesn't know what's happened, and he doesn't know about my St. Louis. He doesn't know about my equation. He didn't know anything. I go, "You know, Bob," because I still had pain in my heart. I was still hurting. I was super tired from the 5 hours or the 3 hours or whatever it was. But I was perplexed by these three groaning people still laying up there. And he said, "The Lord really set you up for some fishing today, didn't he?" I said, "He sure did." He goes, I said, "More than you know." He goes, "Well, maybe I know more than you know." And I said, "Well, what do you mean?" He says, "Well," he goes, "the Lord took me in the night visions last night. Took me in the night visions with him. And I saw you. I saw you today." He goes, "You and the Lord were on a fishing boat." He goes, "A little fishing boat." He said, "And you were so excited because the Lord put a net in the boat." The Lord put the net in the boat. In other words, the Lord's the one that anointed me and set the thing up for this day. He goes, "And you grabbed the net, and the Lord grabbed your hand and said, you can't throw the net today. That's massive evangelism. You can't." He says, "You were so disappointed." He goes, "You were really disappointed today." I go, "Bob, more than you will ever know. You don't even know what happened to me today." He goes, "Oh, I do know. Because the Lord put the net in your reach and then grabbed your hand and said, no, not today." He said, "And then what happened?" He goes, "I don't know how this is going to work out." He goes, "Maybe it's going to happen this week," because they were all back there talking. He said, "He gave you a hook, a big old hook, about a foot long with a big hook on it." He goes, "You knelt down on the side of the boat. And you gave 3 strokes in the water, and you pierced 3 fish right through instantly." I just did that. I just put my finger on 3 people, and they went down like an arrow shot through them. He goes, "And you pierced them right through the heart, and they were soundly converted." He goes, "Now, I know that it hadn't happened yet, but I think you're going to watch it happen this week before it's over." And I said, "Bob, you just don't even know what just happened to me." He says, "Well, let me tell you what the Lord told me to tell you." He said, "The Lord told me to tell you, he's raising up this youth movement." And he said, "Whatever authority he gave you with those 3, that hook those 3 times," he said, "this is the actual word he told me, because I saw him. I saw him with my eyes." He said, "I will give this youth movement 1,000 times the power to pierce hearts in the day that I release them." He goes, "They will throw the net, and the net will break, because the multitudes will come in such power." He says, "And the Lord told me that he set you up to understand what I'm talking about." I said, "Bob, you don't have any idea what you're telling me right now. He goes, Mike, you don't have any idea what I'm telling you right now. Because he doesn't know how deeply clear this was to me about intercession and fasting and groaning and conviction and Finney and Brainerd. He didn't even really know those names. He knew more of the Pentecostal history. And he's, well, I don't really know that much about him. I go, oh, these are my heroes. And there it happened that day. And he said, he goes, let me tell you this. He goes, when the Lord releases this young adult movement, this youth movement, he says, they are going to have, this is the actual word the Lord gave me, because this is an actual number. He said, I will give them 1,000 times the authority that you had to pierce the hearts of people instantly with one word. They will pierce the hearts of multitudes. The nets will break. The catch will be so great. He goes, whatever you do, he says, you don't leave. He always called it the house of the watchful and the wise, because that's what the Lord called it. He says, don't you leave that place of prayer. It's the house of the watchful for the wise. He goes, that's the only place this net is going to be released in fullness, is in the house of the watchful and the wise. So that was that day. That was that day. Okay, now, oh, I love that story, but oh, it was painful. Beloved, it's coming. I'm envisioning an army of 5,000 of these young people. And beloved, I like us old, more than young, you know, older than young people too. I want to do it too, but I see an army of 5,000 20-year-olds, and they've got a vision for apostolic preaching. We've sowed it into them. And we're going to press them to move into this thing. And they're going to have, they're not going to be denied till they break through into a realm of power. Realm of power in their preaching. Okay, so that was April 1983. So totally exciting. But now it's, let's fast forward a few years. March 1984. We're at one of our meetings. It's Tuesday night. I can remember it as sure as can be. I can remember this meeting. Bob Jones came up. He got up and he said, Noel is coming! Noel is coming! Noel is coming! And he sat down. But he goes, there's more to it than that, but I don't know what it is. I don't have any idea what it is. He said, I just heard it in the dream this morning. By I heard the audible voice of the Lord. I heard it. Noel is coming. Noel is coming. I said, maybe it's just prophetic songs. He goes, no, it's more than that. I heard it by the audible voice of the Lord. There's something going on here. Okay, a week goes by. I go to the citywide prayer meeting, and Noel Alexander comes. Most of you know Noel Alexander. He's in Olathe. Just a total comrade in the spirit to me all these years. And I go to citywide prayer meeting a week later, whatever, a week or so, and I walk in at 9 o'clock in the morning, March 1984. There's maybe 40, 50 pastors there. And there's this new guy standing straight off of a Reinhard Bonnke meeting, a Nazarene pastor who didn't believe in the things of the Spirit, went to a Reinhard Bonnke meeting, and was so impacted by the Reinhard Bonnke meeting, he sought the Lord, and the Spirit of God fell on him. This is on a Friday morning, on Thursday night. The Reinhard Bonnke meeting was like a week before, but he was so in turmoil the whole week of, God, I've got to touch the power of God, because he didn't, he wouldn't have had no familiarity at all with anything charismatic. And so he talked to, anyway, so he's in turmoil all week, a deep man of prayer. And so on a Thursday night, he's by himself and he's just, oh God, oh God, oh God. You know, the power of God fell on Noel. He began to speak in tongues. And this was really outside of his comfort zone and outside of his friend's comfort zone. And so this hits him at about, maybe I'm just saying 10 o'clock at night. It was in the evening. And he stays up all night long for 10 straight hours, or however many hours, till 9 the next morning. He stays up all night speaking in tongues. And Matt said, go to that charismatic citywide pastor's meeting, because I don't even know one. He goes, go. So I walk there at 9. Noah's there. Face lit up like an angel. A little exaggeration. But I mean, a brightness on this man's countenance. He'd been up all night. The power of God resting on him. And he sang in his beautiful South African accent. He sang, "I tell you the truth, the power of God is coming. He will shake the nations. He is calling for night and day prayer. I care nothing for anything." I love this guy. I walk up to him, and he's talking 8 or 9 of them with energy and fire. And I listen to him outside the circle, the 6 or 8. And I am falling in love by the second. I go, "I love him. I love him. I love him." And he says, I don't care. This all churches and churchianity, it means nothing if we don't press in and da-da-da-da-da. And he's a brand new guy there who's been, you know, speaking in tongues for 10 hours. And so then, I go to him, they say, "Okay, we got to start the meeting. It's 9. And so I only heard him 4 or 5 minutes. I was so excited. I said, "Hello, my name's Mike Bickle." He goes, "My name is Noel." And my first words, I said, "You're a man." He goes, "Yes." I go, "No. I mean, you don't understand." I go, "Noel is a man." That was what I said. I go, "You're a man." He goes, "Yes." We laugh about that. We've laughed about that for years. I go, "Oh, I mean, my wheels were turning. Oh, my gosh." So I said, "I got to talk to you." He says, "Okay." I said, someone said, "Well, he's been up all night." And he says, "I am full of the power of God. I don't need to sleep right now. I am ready to go." And so I said, okay. So we talk a couple minutes. We get phone numbers. And he said the most endearing thing I've ever heard in not most endearing in my life, but very endearing. I said, "No, I got to talk to you tonight. I can't wait." He goes, "Me neither." I said, "I got a meeting tonight." He said, "So do I." I said, "What time's your meeting?" He goes, "Well," he goes, "for about a year now, we meet every night for intercession, and I won't take anything except for that prayer meeting." And that's what I was doing, too. We've been meeting every night for however many, 8 or 9 months. Oh, no, no. What did I say? Did I say March 87? No, I messed up. This is March 84. This is March 84. Okay, one's at 84, one's at 87. It's March 84. What am I doing in here? Okay, March 84. Okay, and so I go, "For the last 18 months, we've been doing it every night." He says, "So have we." I says, "You can't meet because you're having a permit." I go, "Oh, this is fantastic." I go, "What if we meet tonight?" So we did, 10 o'clock, and we stayed up till 1 or 2 in the morning. And then I said, "Hey, we got to meet again tomorrow." He says, "Absolutely." I said, "Although I got to go to this walk, this march." And he said, I'll march with you." I said, "Good." So we're marching with a couple thousand people in this Christian march down by the plaza, and we're walking. I'm telling him stories of this, and he's telling me, and oh, man, we're loving it. It's so phenomenal. Now, it ends up, the march is a march for Soviet Jews to be released from prison. And they take a picture, a big picture, and put it on the front page of one of the sections, probably the religion section, and it's me and Noel. It's the Soviet Jews, and me and Noel are there because they... We were in the middle so we could talk because in front there was too much noise. And the camera guy came in the middle, and the next day our meeting is documented from the sections of the Kansas City Star. So I said, "No, come with me." I said, "It's important. You got to know this." I go, "Come on, here with me on the phone here," because call up. "Hello, Bob." I said, "Mike here." I says, "I got a friend I want to bring over." He says, "Bring him over. Tell him only this." All I said is, "I got a friend to bring over." He was telling this. "I saw him this morning, and I'm going to put a mirror in front of him. And I'm going to show him his past, and I'm going to show him his future. I'm going to put a mirror in front of him." Okay, so I'm in the car. I go, "No, he's going to put a mirror in front of you." He goes, "Now, like a real mirror?" I go, no. "He's going to tell you something that it's going to be like looking in a mirror." He goes, "Okay, that's good." So I get over there. And we're driving over there about 20, 30 minutes. And Noel says, "Let me tell you before we get there, the most dynamic thing that's ever happened to me." He goes, "It was in the August 1979. He goes, "The power of God fell on me." He goes, "God called me to intercession in 1979. I said, "Me too. I mean, our histories were exactly the same." He goes, "And I've been pressing into this thing, because it's 84 now, for these 5 years. And I mean, our lives were so tracking sovereignly." And I said, "No, this is amazing." He says, "Well, I was in Colorado Springs. And the Holy Spirit, it's 2 in the morning, tells me to pull off the side of the road. My family's sleeping in the car. I pull off. I go out in a valley of fields. He goes, everyone's sleeping, so I get away with it. But he goes, I stand out there, and I heard the voice of God. He goes, I heard his voice. He said, well, how many flowers? He said, there was this vast valley of flowers. He goes, how many flowers? He goes, I heard this from the Lord. How many flowers? And that's all the Lord said to him. And he said, Lord, it's impossible to count. And then the Lord says one more thing. He says, this is the number of souls you will lead into the kingdom. And he sobbed on that in that open field for an hour. Got in his car. His family's asleep. He drives them on. He drives through the night or whatever he does and goes to the hotel somewhere. I think it's important. It was even Colorado Springs. So he's telling me this, and Noah's weeping in the car. We pull up at Bob's house, and he's saying, give me a minute here. You know, I got to get myself composed. We walk in. Bob pulls out this 1976 back of an envelope with coffee stains and yellowed. He said, what's your name? He goes, Noel Alexander. I go, this is Noel. He goes, yeah, it's more than that. And on this coffee-stained yellow envelope that he'd saved Bob for since 76 did, now it's 84, it had on the back of it written in Bob's handwriting, when Major General Alexander comes, then I'm going to begin to assemble this youth army. I'm going to begin to, he says, when Major General Alexander comes, he goes, you're a major general in the spirit. He goes, let me tell you. And he says, I've been waiting for you because I've given this word in two or three people through the years. Bob had verified. I said, remember when I told you guys the General Alexander word, the Major General Alexander? Some of his older friends, when they met me and Noel in 84, when they met us, because they knew Bob back in 75 and 76, they go, oh, we've been waiting for General Alexander for years. And here he is. So we walk in the room, and that's moving. Noel's weeping already. I'm weeping. It's powerful. Bob says, this is a sovereign moment. He goes, let me tell you this. Oh, no, wait. Noel's in the field, and the Lord says one more thing to him. Take off your shoes, for the place where you are is holy, when he showed him the open field. I forgot. That's just very important. So Bob says, here's the mirror I'm going to put in front of you. He goes, this may sound a little poetic, but the Lord means you to take it. It's literal. And Noel looks at me, and I think, I don't know. He says, this may sound a little poetic, but you are like a man that is standing before a vast field of flowers. He says, the Lord told me that this is the inheritance that you will lead into the kingdom through intercession. He goes, you may not understand that. Of course, we're finished. No, Noah just told me that in the car. That's the most serious experience he's ever had. And then Bob says, and the Lord told me to tell you guys when you gathered. I knew there would be a gathering today. He says, this will mean something to you. Let's take our shoes off for the day. This day before the Lord is holy, because God is going to make you guys partners in intercession. He goes, you don't know what it's going to look like, but the Lord is going to complete what he begins with you. And he says, and it will bring a harvest of souls beyond anything that you could imagine.